Hi, everybody, and welcome to another edition of People Make a Difference. I'm your host, Danny Brissell, and this is the show where we profile individuals and organizations that are having a significant positive impact on our community. It is my pleasure today to have with us Dr. Kathy Magliotta, who is the first female board president of the American Heart Association. Thank you so much for joining us today, Kathy.
Hey, Danny. Thanks so much for inviting me.
I mean, you're just an amazing person. I honestly have no idea how you do it. You're one of the very few female cardiothoracic surgeons in the world. You run the Women's Cardiac Services Department over at St. John's Hospital over in Santa Monica. How do you do all of this?
Well, it helps that I go 150 miles an hour all the time. I like to tell people I have a plate, and it's so full right now that I can't even see the plate anymore.
Oh, wow. I honestly don't. And you're a mother of two sons.
And I'm
two
a mommy.
Sons,
very
a five-year-old
exciting.
And a seven-year-old. What are their names?
Nicholas and Gabriel.
Okay. Yeah. And your husband, Nick?
Nick is a liver transplant surgeon at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center. So we're a two-surgeon family, so we tend to spin quite a bit, but we have very interesting dinner conversation, I'll tell you that.
Oh, I absolutely. How did you guys meet?
Nick and I actually met, as you would expect, in the operating room, and it was love at first sight. He was a tall, handsome surgeon, and I could see even with his mask on that he had these beautiful green eyes and cheekbones you could park a Volkswagen on, and I thought, I have to find out who this mystery man is, and I basically hunted him down.
I think that's a very good strategy. Hunting, I mean, you're a woman that goes for it all. I mean,
yeah.
you've done so many things,
yeah.
And now it's almost like, I hope it's not the pinnacle of your career, but you're now the board chair at American Heart Association. Tell us a little bit about all the wonderful work that American Heart Association does here just in Los Angeles.
Well, that's been very exciting for me. I just came in July as the president. I've been on the board for a few years. And I got to tell you, for me as a heart surgeon, where I'm addressing heart disease every day and only able to really impact one or two patients at a time, the American Heart Association helps me to impact hundreds of patients at a time or hundreds of people potentially with heart disease because, as you probably know, the American Heart Association is a nationally recognized nonprofit organization, and they have two very simple, very, very important goals. Number one, to educate the public, to build awareness about heart disease and stroke, which are our number one and number three killers, and number two, to raise money for research to prevent and cure heart disease and stroke. And so by interacting with the American Heart Association like this, I feel like I can reach out and help so many more patients and potentially people than just, you know, the one or two people I operate on each day.
Well, and I mean, one of the things that just amazes me about it, you're in a very male-dominated industry. I mean, when I always think of the movie The Doctor with William Hurt and how he was just this this jerk jerk surgeon. And
I'm not a jerk
you're
surgeon.
Not a jerk.
Thank
of course
you, Danny.
You're not. You're a woman. I always like my women surgeons. The men always are the ones without the hearts. But how does a woman enter a male-dominated field like that and achieve such success as you have?
Well, it's very difficult, Danny. There's a secret handshake.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Okay.
No, it was a struggle. You know, for me, honestly, the biggest thing for me, Danny, was I never had a mentor. You know, when I went through my training, everywhere I trained, and believe me, it takes about 17 years to train as a heart surgeon after high school, between college and medical school, and then all the training and surgery and residency and that type of thing. And throughout all of my training, there was never a woman surgeon that I could use as a mentor to kind of give me that vision that said, yes, Kathy, you can do this.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, quite honestly, if I had a dollar for every time someone said to me, oh, you don't want to go into cardiac surgery, you want to go into pediatric surgery or plastic surgery because you're a girl, I'd be a very rich woman and wouldn't have to be a heart surgeon. But the lack of mentorship was really something for me, and I think that was the thing that bothered me most going through. But, you know, eventually I just held my ground, and I like to say that I had to be, you know, half as good or twice as good to get half the credit, but I just worked very, very hard, and I stayed very focused on wanting to be a heart surgeon and have that be my career. And I didn't let the gender thing bother me.
Well, and I don't think, I always think it's almost belittling when we make the gender thing an issue because, I mean, you're just a very prestigious surgeon. It's not just a female surgeon. And you wrote about your experiences in a book that was just published called Healing Hearts. I was hoping that maybe you could share with us a little bit about your book published by Random House.
Thank you. Yeah, I wrote the book. It came out in February. And the it came out in the launch for Women's Heart Health Month. And basically, it was a book that really started out as a way to educate women about their number one killer, which is heart disease. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you're probably aware, but maybe some of your audience isn't, that heart disease actually kills more women than all cancer combined. So, Danny, if I take breast cancer, which, you know, if I fill a room with women and ask them, what's your number one health concern, mm-hmm. they all say breast cancer. But if I take breast cancer, liver, ovarian, colon, lung cancer, and combine them, it doesn't even equal the number of women dying from heart disease. So I started out by wanting to write a book about heart disease in women so I could educate women about their number one killer. But the problem is, women don't just wake up in the morning and say, oh, I'd love to go to the bookstore today mm-hmm. and just buy a very dry textbook about heart disease in women. So I wanted to make it a little more interesting and actually include stories, very tragic, very poignant stories of women who I have taken care of throughout my career and who have died from heart disease in a way to educate women. And then the book sort of morphed into a memoir when I met this terrific agent who did actually sell the book to Random House. And this agent said to me, you know, Kathy, I want to hear the story about heart disease in women, and I want to hear the story about your patients, but what I really want to hear is your story mm-hmm. about growing up on a small town in upstate New York where my mom and dad weren't physicians to becoming a heart surgeon juggling a family and careers. And so that's how it morphed into this memoir. So in the book you will learn about, you know, this very prestigious club, the Cardiothoracic Surgery Club, and how I managed to make my way into that club and develop my life around it. So.
Well, let's talk a little bit more, I mean, because I want people to buy the book, and people can buy the book if they go to your website, KathyMagliotto.com. Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful book, but for those of us that, I mean, I'm very fascinated by your childhood, and how does one who's not the physician's daughter, how did you get your, well, first of all, where did you find your passion for medicine, and what steps did you take to make that passion become a reality?
Well, for me, like I said, my parents, I mentioned they weren't physicians, but they did something that was very, very critical, Danny, I got to tell you. My parents were tremendous supports for me. Anything I wanted to do, they told me to go for it. There was never any boundaries. In the book, I write a little passage that says that parents give you two things. One is roots, and the other is wings. And that's exactly what my mom and dad did. So when I went to them and said, I want to be a doctor, they said, that's wonderful, Kathy. We want you to do that. And I think that's a message to moms and dads out there to encourage your children to be whatever they want to mm-hmm. be. And I think that was one of the biggest messages in my life. And I think it also helped that I grew up on a farm where we had to work as kids in the farm. And I learned that, you know, hard work is not something to fear. In fact, hard work actually builds character. And I think that I wasn't afraid to work hard, and that hard work paid off for me in medical school and onward throughout my training, which was very grueling and very rigorous.
So. You have a quote which I love, which is how I wish I could be lazy just once. Hard work is everything that you are is hard work. Now,
right.
You wound up going to Union College, beautiful college yeah. in Schenectady, New York, and you majored in that easy major, biochemistry.
Right,
that
piece of cake.
All the football players are always majoring in biochemistry. Right. And then, so from Union College, then you went on to Case Western in Cleveland?
Well, from Union College, I spent a year doing research, okay. in primate research, which kind of helped to build my resume to apply to medical school. Mm-hmm. Then I went to medical school at Albany Medical Center. I don't want to bore you with my whole
education. But you've been all over the place, and I like Albany. That you've been all over the place. That's a good story.
I kind of slowly worked my way out here to the West Coast, mm-hmm. hitting every state along the way.
Yeah.
But, no, I went to Albany Medical Center in Albany, New York, and then Case Western Reserve, as you mentioned, in Cleveland. And then from there, I did training for 6 years as a surgeon, as a general surgeon, both at Akron General Medical Center, and I did some rotations at the Cleveland Clinic as well in Cleveland. And then, let me see, from there, I then did my training as a cardiac surgeon at Loyola University in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And then
very
from there,
then
I met
there.
My husband, yeah. very important
mm-hmm.
thing. And then from there, I actually wanted to go on to be a heart transplant and lung transplant surgeon. So then I did an extra year of fellowship at the University of Pittsburgh in transplantation.
And then you wound up, when you were here, did you start off at Cedars-Sinai?
Yes, in 1999, uh-huh. then I joined at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center. I've specialized in heart transplantation and actually something called artificial heart technology, which I'm still very passionate about. And those are machines that we can actually implant into the chest and can take control of the cardiac function while a patient's awaiting transplantation.
You know, it's really neat. It's fascinating talking to you, Kathy, because you're making everything accessible to somebody like me. I mean, I don't understand a lot of the medical terminology all the time, and you're making it very approachable. Is this the same bedside manner you have with your patients?
You know, honestly, a lot of my patients tell me that. I think that that also has to be, you know, has a lot to do with how I was brought up. And what I do, Danny, is I do very simply this. I treat every patient as if they're a family member. Mm-hmm. So they're my mom, they're my dad, they're my brother, they're my sister. And I treat them like that. And if I treat them like that, then I never go wrong in my care. I always treat them with dignity and respect and kindness and compassion. And I'm kind of the type of doctor that will walk into a patient's room and literally sit at the patient's bed with them. Sit mm-hmm. on the bed with them and get in their space and talk to them and really listen. I like to call doctors who don't do that doorknob doctors, where they've got the one uh-huh. hand on the doorknob and the other, you know, they're all posturing sort of away from the patient. But again, and I recommend this to medical students as they go along their training, just treat your patients like their family mm-hmm. and you'll always do right by a patient. Well, so thank you for noticing that bedside manner.
Hopefully you like your family.
How's your gallbladder?
Exactly.
Okay, good. Just kidding.
How did you turn out that way, though? Because I'm always fascinated, because this is my passion, is I think it's a responsibility to mentor other people and for people to be our mentors. Now, you had really wonderful parents. It seems like that's where you're getting most of your bedside manner. Professionally, did you have anybody that was able to mentor to kind of guide you into that bedside manner?
You know, I would say that I learned quite a bit of what not to do sometimes mm-hmm. by watching physicians, but there were some key physicians during my training that showed me about compassion and bedside manner. And yet, in the book, I write about compassion, and I say in the book that compassion isn't on the bell curve, so as a student, you're never graded on that, mm-hmm. and that's really kind of sad, because I think that's the one thing lacking in medicine. But along the way, you have to find those moments, those teachable moments along, you know, your training. And sometimes they're not so obvious to you. You have to seek them out. And so I spent a lot of time just watching mannerisms of physicians and watching how patients responded. And it was how I learned that interaction mm-hmm. with patients, I think, that was so crucial. But I got to tell you, Danny, I didn't always have that. I mean, there was a time in my career, and we talked about this in the green room, that mm-hmm. that period of my career where I had to be so tough that I had no area of vulnerability in my life that I put on this full metal jacket.
You call it your full metal jacket.
That we talk about in the book. And it that full metal jacket is something I swear that I stitched every ounce of fabric and made it this tough exterior that no one could come near me, no one could get close to me. And that's kind of how I survived some of the more difficult moments in my residencies.
Would you think that maybe that's one of the reasons you've had so much success? I'm thinking about this because, and this is, sometimes it's those extra challenges that help us make us stronger, because I was just watching recently a making of The Silence of the Lambs, and Jodie Foster was talking yeah. about how she trained for the role of Clarice Starling, and so she worked with this woman who's one of the very few FBI agents at mm-hmm. Quantico, mm-hmm. and this woman mentored her on the types of things that she had to do to put on her full metal jacket. She
right.
could never show weakness or vulnerability in
Absolutely.
Front of anybody.
Absolutely.
But then she did have that outlet where she was allowed, she did it to when she was alone. She had that outlet. I'm curious, right. was your experience the same?
It's almost exactly that. You know, but here's what I found, that when I wore that full metal jacket, I couldn't get close to patients. I mm-hmm. maintained this distance, this detachment. And it took me a lifetime to learn how to take that jacket and off and put it on when I need it. So when I'm in the operating room, and I describe it in the book in a chapter called Fire and Ice, and I describe that sort of icy focus that I can have in the operating room, so that's when the jacket's on. Mm-hmm. But then I'm able to slip it off when I need to talk to the patient's family about how that patient did in surgery. And it took me a long time to realize, my God, I can be vulnerable. It's okay. Mm-hmm. It's okay for me to be at a patient's bedside when they die. It's okay. I'm not going to fall apart. I'm not going to crumble at that. And in fact, that's a way to express what I think is the ultimate dignity for a patient, and that is to never let them die alone.
Mm.
And it took an entire lifetime or career, if you will, to learn that.
That's pretty amazing yeah. that you are able to accomplish all those things.
Thank you.
I just find you fascinating. That's what the book makes it so readable.
Yeah.
Just take us through this past weekend. a typical four-hour shift in your in your job?
Yeah, so I was on call this weekend, and I had to make rounds. And unfortunately, my rounds started with the death of a patient that my partner and I had operated on earlier in the week. And she was very elderly and very, very sick. Her heart was so weak after the surgery. It just gave out. And I started my rounds at that patient's bedside at the death of that patient. Then I had to carry through all the rest of my rounds. And the last patient I saw was a young woman who we had done a lung resection on. We'd actually taken out a portion of her lung that contained a cancer. And all this woman wanted to know was, what did my pathology report show? So I went on the computer. Thank God her pathology report came back. I printed it up, and she was cured of cancer. Right? The report showed that the tumor was completely removed, all the margins were negative, no tumor left behind, and not a single lymph node with cancer. So this woman beat cancer, and I gave her this printed out pathology report, and I told her, this is your gift. This is your gift today. This is going to be the greatest day of your life. So I hit rock bottom and climbed to Everest, right? All in the span of 4 hours. And it's those constant ups and downs in medicine that I think are the beauty of what we do. I mean, what a great day. What a great day to be able to tell someone, you know, that they are cured from cancer. And also, on the other flip side of it, death can be a very beautiful, very dignified release from life. And this woman who was very, very sick, it was her time. And what an honor. What an honor to be there with her and with her sister when she passed.
So, I've never heard it described that way. It's beautiful. How do you maintain that balance, Kathy? I mean, you have these highs and lows. I'm thinking about the balance of you're a mom, you're a wife, and you're surrounded by men at work. You got sons, you've got your husband and everything.
Right.
How do you maintain this balance? And you have a positive attitude. You're making a contribution to the community with your involvement with American Heart Association. I know you're involved in lots of other things too. They all relate around that passion of, ironically, the heart. How do you share that heart with everybody but maintain some balance for yourself?
Well, the balance I maintain is probably the same that you do, having young kids at home, almost identical, I guess, our kids in age. And that is my children. In fact, if you read the very first page of the book, I dedicate the book to Nicholas and Gabriel because they heal my heart every day. I mean, Danny, when I come home, my children, like your children, they don't care what kind of a day you had. They don't care that mommy's got blood on her shoes from taking care of a gunshot wound in the chest a mere 2 hours earlier. All they care is I'm home and it's a great evening to spend with mommy. And so honestly, those children running to me and hugging me and telling me they love them, that just evens out my day.
Wow.
That, and I also have a great husband, and he and I, thank God, I'm married to a surgeon, right?
Yeah.
He totally gets my life. He understands my day. And he and I get up very, very early in the morning. We make a pot of coffee, and we talk about our day. And that is another thing that maintains wonderful balance in my life, is he and I sort of talk about our day and kind of work through some of our problems. So it's great.
Well, and how do you guys manage the family? I mean, because you both have ridiculous schedules. I mean, absolutely ridiculous. I mean, how do you make sure that the kids, so who's taking the kids to school and things
like
that?
Well, that's a great spin, I'll tell you. It's constant texting and emailing and phone calls. It's constant communication. You know, again, being two surgeons, we have a lot of unpredictability in our lives. And being able to roll with that is great. I mean, if I had a surgeon husband who got mad every time I wasn't home at 5 o'clock on the dot, I probably wouldn't be married. But Nick really understands me, and he understands that, you know, there are things that I'm supposed to show up for at home that I can't, and he'll fill in, and vice versa. We just completely help each other out.
Well, and you're leading a fascinating life. I saw that the American Red Cross honored you at a gala with the cast of Grey's Anatomy.
Right.
You've actually
and with Shonda Rhimes. Yeah,
yeah, you've
terrific.
Actually worked with Grey's Anatomy. How did you get involved in this, or did they seek you out?
Well, that's a funny story. So in my operating room at St. John's, the scrub nurse in the OR, which is the nurse who actually hands you instruments, so when I asked for a scalpel or a hemostat or a forceps, She's the nurse who hands the instruments. She's actually on Grey's Anatomy, and you'll see her in every OR scene, and she's actually handing instruments to all the actors and actresses on the show. And so many of them have come to our OR through her invitation to kind of watch us operate and learn how to do that on camera. So one time I was in the operating room, and there was someone standing at the head of the OR table, and he looked at me and said, "Well, who are you?" Very, you know, sort of incredulous, like, "Who is this woman, this nurse or whoever, you know, operating?" And I said, "Well, who the heck are you? This is my OR." Uh-huh. He said, "Well, I'm a producer on Grey's Anatomy." And I said, "Well, I'm a heart surgeon." And then I started to berate him about why he didn't have a female heart surgeon on the show. And lo and behold, 2 weeks later, there's now female heart surgeons on the show.
Good for them. That's
so great. I've worked with each of the characters that have been on, Brooke Smith, and recently Kim Raver, and they've come and spent time with mm-hmm. me and sort of learned how to be a heart surgeon, and they're doing a pretty good job, I would have to say.
Well, and you have kind of an important responsibility, is you never had those mentors. Now you are the mentor to people.
Right. What's
your message for people that want to become that little girl out there who wants to become a cardiac specialist?
Well, here's the really neat thing about my book, which I did not anticipate, and I don't know why I didn't, but I never thought of the book as being something that would be inspirational for young girls.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why. It's my life, and I thought, well, this is really a book for moms trying to juggle career and family, or this is a book for women wanting to learn about heart disease. But the most incredible fan mail I've gotten is from young girls. I'm talking about middle school and high school girls. In fact, I had one high school girl do a book report on me, which is so sweet.
Mm-hmm.
And she sent it to me, and it was such a sweet thing. That actually mentoring young women has really been something that I've been trying to do more and more of. And I've been mentoring young girls in some of the schools in the area that will come and spend the day with me and that type of thing. But the biggest message I can give to them when they come and meet me is again the message that I said earlier, and that is that you can do anything and you can do it all.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to give up family to have a career. You don't have to give up career for family. If you want one or the other, no problem. If you want both, no problem. You just have to set each goal and achieve it. And what I always did is never predicated one goal on another. So I never said, well, you know, if I get into college, then I will be a doctor. I never made those mm-hmm. if-then statements. I always simply said, I'm going to get into college, I'm going to be a doctor. And those positive goals and setting one goal at a time and knocking them down is really how women should do it.
I think you have pretty fascinating action steps, because you set your goals, you have a great message of you worked hard. That's a message that everybody can listen to.
Nothing came easy.
What drew you to the heart in particular?
Oh, that's a great story. So you have to indulge me with one story.
I want it.
Okay.
Give me all the stories
you want. How much time do we have?
Three shows with you,
okay,
Kathy.
Great.
So
that was a moment that I wrote about in the book, obviously. It's mm-hmm. it's really the moment that changed my life and set my path toward the heart. And it's a chapter called Love at First Touch. So here I was, an intern in general surgery. And now, to be a heart surgeon, you have to spend about 5 to 6 years training as a surgeon, mm-hmm. which is actually what Grey's Anatomy is about. The characters are surgeons in training, and they're in their internship their first year. So there I am, the lowly intern, and my job is to stay out of the way and not kill anybody. Very simple, stay out of the way, not kill anybody. So there I am standing at the OR board one morning, and that's the board where they list all the surgeries for the day. And I'm just staying there, you know, minding my own business mm-hmm. with my two goals, stay out of the way, don't kill anybody, right? And all of a sudden a nurse runs up to me, and she grabs me and she says, Oh my God, come with me. Dr. Netter needs you in OR7. And I'm thinking, oh, she can't possibly be talking to me. Mm-hmm. I'm just the lowly intern, and I just started my internship. And she drags me into an operating room, and before I know it, there I am, thrown into an OR. And I look around, and it's just complete and utter mayhem in the operating room. There are people running around, people are screaming, and in the middle of this is an OR table with a man on it with his chest open, blood just shooting out.
Oh, wow.
And this surgeon says to me, get some gloves on and get up here and hold the heart. And I thought to myself, what, get up there where all the blood uh-huh. is shooting at? I think not. And one of the things that I think you need to know about me is I don't know if you've noticed my huge hands. I can palm a basketball.
Prerequisite for a
surgeon. Well, these are perfect to hold the human heart, right,
ah.
Danny? So I put my gloves on. I didn't even know how to glove up and all that at that
mm-hmm.
point. But I managed to figure that out, stepped up to the operating table, and I just palmed that heart. Perfect for that surgeon. I held it steady while it was beating, and he sewed the hole shut, saved the patient's life. And I thought to myself, what an incredible thing to touch the heart every day. So I said to uh-huh. the surgeon, do you do this every day? And he said, well, do what every day? And I said, well, do you get to hold the human heart every day? And he says, well, of course I do. I'm a heart surgeon. That was it for me.
Did he say anything positive to you?
No. At least he didn't yell at me.
Oh, man.
I was so happy not to be yelled at.
That is just amazing.
And
I mean,
that was
you've had
it.
A lot of this. Yeah. You haven't even had encouragement in a lot of these things, and you just went for it.
Yeah.
I absolutely love that message. Now, I'd be remiss if we didn't talk a little bit more about the American Heart Association and your involvement with that. I mean, you've talked about, you know, heart attacks, number one killer in America.
Right.
You know, what are some things that people can do to prevent heart disease?
Well, you know, one of the most important goals, I think, for the American Heart Association is awareness.
Mm-hmm.
And really, we've learned a valuable lesson. We mentioned breast cancer earlier, right? We've learned a terrific and valuable lesson from breast cancer, and that is if we can build awareness in the public, we can really fight disease. With breast cancer, we have a great awareness program. Women go out and get their mammograms mm-hmm. every year. They know how to check themselves and do self-checks for lumps in their breast. And we've been able to detect it earlier because of that. The same thing has to be done with heart disease. So the most important thing that people can do is educate themselves about heart disease, and that is knowing the risks for heart disease and modifying those risks. And one of the goals, actually, for the American Heart Association for the next decade to 2012 is something called Life Simple 7. It's a very wonderful program, and it's basically seven areas of your life that we want you to examine and we want you to change. And those seven areas have to do with the risk factors for heart disease.
Mm-hmm.
So we want you to diet, we want you to exercise, we want you to lose weight, control your blood pressure, control your cholesterol. If you're a diabetic, control your diabetes and your blood sugars,
mm-hmm.
and we want you not to smoke. Those seven things.
Wow.
And if you can modify those seven things, Danny, we can prevent heart disease. And that's one of the biggest messages I can send out today from the American Heart Association.
Wonderful. And American Heart Association, we've been flashing the website on the screen throughout this broadcast.
Thank
I want to make sure
great.
People get involved in that all the time. What are some of the things, you know, people want to get involved in American Heart Association. I know you do a number of events with numbers of different ages. What can
right.
people do to get involved with
anybody AHA? Can be involved. That's a wonderful thing. And it's really all ages. We were talking earlier about the jump rope programs
yeah.
in the schools, which is great. I mean, it's absolutely frightening to me, Danny, that 25% of kids ages 2 to 5, these are toddlers, 25% of kids aged 2 to 5 are obese in the United States. Crazy, right? So getting that educational program in schools for eating right and exercise and activity
mm-hmm.
through the jump rope program is important. In the fall, we always do a heart walk, which is one of our biggest events, and that's about 10,000 people
that's
show
right.
up. We usually host it at the Rose Bowl, and people come to that, and it's a way for us to raise awareness, and we actually raise a lot of money. In
okay.
fact, our goal is to raise about $1 to $1.3 million through that one event. In the springtime, April, May, we usually do the Go Red for Women Luncheon, which is a particular event to raise money for heart disease in women. So we've got events really running throughout the year. And you can go online to the website and get involved. We'd love to have you. It's a total volunteer organization,
get
but
involved.
We may just sign you up.
That's and I used to do jump rope for heart when I was
oh,
a
you
teacher.
Did?
I absolutely
oh,
think
wonderful.
That's wonderful.
Thank
and
you for that.
It's just been such an honor to have you. I want to have you,
you
on again, Kathy.
You're I'd
just,
love to do
you're
it.
You're just doing wonderful. Again, it's Dr. Kathy Magliotto. I hope you make sure to get a copy of Kathy's wonderful book, Healing Hearts. I've been with Dr. Kathy Magliotto today talking about her involvement with the American Heart Association. Folks, remember, there's people like this all around us in the community that make a difference every single day, and you can too. Join us again next time. God bless.